So welcome to this session on cinema, actually, and it's a part of a lecture and conversation series curated by Riaz, titled Art, Life and Waste. Here this session is about cinema, in the sense what we are trying to do is like we are trying to structure our conversation or in our presentation in three parallel tracks. It may not be a conversation, actually. People are everyone will have their own take on three moments in cinematic history. That is what we are planning to do. One is the moment of origins of cinema. Then the next moment would be the shift from analog or celluloid to digital. And the third is the present moment, the fragmentation of the screen. So this is how it is structured. What we have planned is like, most probably we'll talk for 5 minutes each on each moment, on each aspect of what we talked about. Then we'll take three rounds and then go to the audience for questions and your observations about the whole thing. So I'll just start with the originary moment, the birth of cinema, so-called. A lot of, supposed to cinema as we see now is supposed to have, originated in 1895, Lumiere, everybody knows that. Even before that, there are a lot of, precursors of cinema, pre-cinema practices that were all around. Like Edison and all lots of zoetropes, different kinds of ways in which film was seen and experimented with in different ways. And one thing about cinema is that like the moment it is invented, Lumiere says it is an invention without a future. He thought once the first fascination with these magical images ends, cinema won't go much far. That is what he thought. Again, Edison had a different take on it. Edison said, actually, cinema is an interesting kind of technology with which actually you can record historical events and also maybe it will help in scientific experiments. That is what he thought, actually, especially medicine and all that, it may help. That's what he thought. But film, the history of film didn't get limited to this, but it just went far and wide. Actually, if you look at the history of cinema, the first 10 years, it had gone to all the continents in the world. Second thing is like wherever cinema went, cinema also took back images. That is the kind of equipment they had was you could screen images, it is also a camera. So wherever it went, it also brought back images. So what happened was there is a kind of, it triggered a circulation, a global circulation of images for the first time in the world. And if you look at the first 20 years of cinema until the coming of sound, you can say it was the only time in the history of human civilization that whole humanity had an art form. Common art form, like Chaplin, it's a kind of, it could be understood anywhere, like it can be enjoyed anywhere, whether it be Africa, Asia, or Latin America, and Europe. So there is a moment of, so what I want to focus is, one is this moment of globality. It is global from the beginning. It traveled all over the world. Second thing is like, it was always considered as a mass art, as a vulgar art, in a sense. Well, from the beginning, there is this kind of love-hate relationship with literature, which is supposed to be elite, kind of elitist art form, theater, opera, a lot of elite art forms, which actually had cinema as a kind of enemy. Like this, for instance, somebody like, writer like Virginia Woolf says, cinema is actually a cannibal. It actually, cannibalizes other art forms, like high art forms, like literature, it actually cannibalizes to the lowest common denominator of the taste of the masses. This is the kind of take it had. So it had a kind of globality, it had a kind of, it triggered a global circulation of images. It was seen as a mass art. And all over the world, the first viewers of cinema, the audience of cinema were actually the industrial masses all over the world. Like they were the first people who migrated from villages to the city. They migrated as part of industrialization. They had lost their roots in a sense that they found their home, their dreams in cinema. So cinema had a kind of different kind of a trajectory as an art form, which is rather different from other art forms. Like once sound comes in, cinema suddenly becomes regional. Suddenly Japanese cinema, Hindi cinema, and Korean cinema emerges. Before that, it was just cinema. So this is one aspect which I would like to focus on as its globality, cinema as a mass art. Second, cinema as publicness of cinema. Because cinema is always a public art. That is why I believe, despite the invention of several kinds of you know, personalized, domesticated home theater format, cinema still exists because that magic is still there, where you watch a big screen, dark theater, you're sitting alone with others, a womb-like atmosphere, looking at big images. That the magic is there. That has something to do with publicness that actually distinguishes it from other kinds of art experiences, art forms. So I will just leave it here and
thank you, CS, for the introduction. Since you were looking at the advent of cinema and the early phase of what could be defined as cinematic, given this gathering and given the situation that we face currently, I guess it is time to actually, with the advent of 100 odd years of cinematograph, it is really important to now revisit and look the idea of what is cinematic. In the process also, look at what is film, cinema, cinematics actually. So cinema is no more something seen in a dark room or a hall anymore. I would say, like, you know, it's very prophetic what he says, that the Lumieres, when they first showed the arrival of the train at the Cinemathek, they said cinema is an invention without the future. So I keep telling my students actually that, you know, the cinema has not even been invented. So, you know, this, it is in a continuous churning out process. But I think the context is very important, because I think let us look at what is the phenomenology, phenomenologically, I mean technologically, there has been a lot of advent, okay, from the digital to from the analog to the digital. And I am more interested, probably Priya could talk much more in another area, that, you know, phenomenologically, how does cinema affect, you know, to our senses? In that sense, I think globalization kind of created probably the idea of what are you assimilating from it actually, and what are the differentiation of globalization. Another important factor could actually probably round up our discussion is the question of hybridization actually. Now this word hybrid is in the air, and let's try to define it probably within this short span of time. Cultural hybridization actually comes with a two-way process. I would call it a dialectics actually, in a sense that, you know, what is the interaction between the local and the global? It is separating from the idea of the origin, but it is also assimilating, and then a very different amorphous form is being made out actually. So in that context, I am very keen to relook at the early phase of cinema, because of one reason, that what did it actually do? Like, there's this seminal book written by Bazin, which is What is Cinema? So where is cinema now actually? Now that we need to relook. So in that sense, he was trying to say that the cinematograph was actually trying to look at the dramaturgy of nature. So the classicism associated with realism need to be relooked within the advent of the digital technologies today. So you see, one of the advent was that, you know, there are pre-runners to the cinematic before the Lumieres, you know, where people were in the 18th and the 19th century, you know, small machines were invented, like phantasmagoria, or say something like the panorama, zeotrope, or phinakistoscope, or the kinetic scope, or whatever. So I think there was this whole idea that, you know, cinema was getting into the realm of what is illusionary, you know, what is the illusionary quality of cinema actually. And definitely with this whole emergence of vision and, you know, science, for example, the persistence of vision, so that, you know, the whole apparatus was invented, and then this whole idea of cinema begins. But, you know, what the idea of realism that the cinema in the early phase faced was in opposition of something, in opposition of its own context of addressing, say, for example, what is illusionary, what is empiricism, and what kind of differentiation it would make in terms of its projection and exhibition. In this context, I would like to say something which we were actually talking, you know, because in the early phase, irrespective of the fascist propaganda, some of the people who actually vouched and promoted cinema were actually fascist. Benito Mussolini was instrumental in bringing the Venice Film Festival. Hitler did a lot of work, same with Leni Riefenstahl. But, you know, what I'm trying to say is that, you know, spectator, the emergence of the spectator is a very important point as a mass subject, actually. Now, this actually is the earliest, I mean, this is pre-World War, and post-World War, you also have what the idea of citizen is, actually. And that is also a phase when, you know, people like André Bazin started writing, you know. Probably André Merlot was the first one to look at what is the idea of a shot, the successive juxtaposition of shots which created duration, actually, in cinema. Now, that aspect is very important because that's also the time when, you know, film theory came to existence. The cinephile, actually, the cinema goer existed, and this whole idea of the dark room, actually. And that mediation is something which is of great importance. So I think this phase of early cinema actually contributed a lot. Now, what has now happened is actually this whole question, we need to re-look into the question of what is the question relating to the aspect of immersion of an audience, actually. So maybe this is the dilemma, perhaps we can unravel in the next few things.
Huh? It's on. So, A, I don't come from a film history background like both CS and Vipin do, but it has always kind of captured my interest. And actually, because since I got invited into this panel, I went back to the encyclopedia and tried to see what really was the history of cinema and why are we talking about... It actually started, I think, after... Scorsese mentioned in the Cannes Film Festival, if I'm right, about the death of cinema, right? And then it triggered my thought, like, why are we talking about the death of cinema? Because people like us actually feel, like, who are actually working as practitioners in the space right now, feel it's actually the advent of cinema. And so, and then coming into this panel, I thought it was a good opportunity. Like many of you sitting here probably may or may not know about the history of cinema. And to try and understand what does it really mean in terms of aesthetics, in terms of, did people really get concerned so much? Was it really an art form or was it a market? Because a lot of people always said that the film, as Vipin rightly pointed out, attracted a lot of the masses, and probably which is why it got the attention of the fascists. It had a lot of state support in the early years. And it comes back to thinking that whether it is form or format, or even content, and this idea of commune was very much affected by the idea of market, in my view. So if you look back, maybe even like when the Lumiere brothers came in, like all people were trying to do was they were trying to put you know, if you're talking about in today's context, you're trying to put a few images together, right? Like an Instagram, like putting few unrelated images together and trying to make something out of it. It may not be a story, it may not even be a narration, right? It could be something, what they were trying to unravel, as Vipin said, what is the idea of this illusion? Because you were trying to suddenly see when you were, all you had as imagery then was fixed paintings. There were people who were painters who were trying to see motion in pictures. But the first time you could see motion in photography was when cinema came in. So people were just trying to put frames together. The biggest, I think one of the biggest length of the films was if you could manage to make a full reel of cinema, it was a big length at that point. And so it could be a set of images which are connected to each other, there could be a set of images that are totally not connected to each other. And so that gave also the fluidity of form. The first time, I think, when people started talking about narration, and please correct me if I'm wrong, was when Georges Méliès came into the entire picture, right? And he brought in the idea of narrative, because he was like, I want to tell this story. The Lumiere guy said that I'm not going to give you the camera, so he makes his own camera. And then he goes and starts becoming, he produces 5 films. He becomes a producer, single, like one-time actor. He makes his own films, sells them, becomes a distributor, and then projects this thought into this guy called Edwin Porter, who comes back and says, oh, maybe I can make more than one reel. And so the idea of length comes into picture, right? Otherwise, it was just like, Namalipo Kanana were a YouTube channel, were a 2-minute video pole iron. So to this whole idea of form emerging from something which is extremely short to the idea of making it longer to something like the idea of Nickelodeon theaters, right, which was very prominent in the US, because most of these theater spaces were occupied by the not so rich classes, right? So it was called Nickelodeon because you could pay a couple of nickels and 5 to 10 nickels and you could actually see and entertain yourself to something which was totally unique at that point. If it just lasts for 2 minutes, 5 minutes, 10 minutes. Matter of fact, the first big hit, the Gent robbery, train robbery or whatever, was just 12 minutes long. It was silent, supposedly according to the encyclopedia. While it's called the silent film, there was a lot of ruckus and noise amongst the audience. So there was this engagement of the idea of a commune, right, which kind of disappeared slowly when the markets came in and when the globalization came in at that point of time. And you had like this French company called, I don't know what it was called, along with a few other companies who started consolidating the efforts because they saw there is a lot of money even in nickels.
Pathé.
Pathé came in, the first female director came in at that point of time. You had like this, all this movement of consolidation. It's exactly like you see in other markets, whether it's airlines, whether you see in every market, because there's, when there is a mass appeal, there is a chance for consolidation, right? And that's when you have people like MPPC, when Edison kind of harnessed on this entire aspect and said, let's make money out of it. And they actually, you know, they actually made sure that everybody bought their film, everybody bought their camera, literally monopoly. In today's times, you would probably go to a competition court for it. And then you have these independent filmmakers who come in, like, you have the Paramounts of the world, you have the Goldwyn, like all of these MGMs and whom we think are big studios today were actually independent filmmakers who fought against the system which MPPC got in, made independent films, got in the star systems to fight MPPC, and then took MPPC out around the 1920s, came back, installed the star system to benefit themselves, became studios themselves today, and then make people like Scorsese come and say that there is death of cinema today because these so-called independent filmmakers are no more independent. So this whole idea of austere cinema, which, you know, auteur cinema, which people like Basin got in, is kind of, I don't know how relevant it is because it's been so much, cinema, unlike other forms of art, has been driven so much by the markets. That the history feels like coming a full round today, especially with Netflix and OTT channels, challenging these tapa, challenging the idea of star, because if you have a good narrative, which goes back to the kind of system which George got in, right? And he said that, oh, I'm a single actor, I have a camera, I can make my own camera, I can do my own stuff. To today, what you have in OTT channels where if you wanted to make a certain imagery of your kind, whoever it is around this audience, can make it and make it big or make it small or make it in any which format. Making the entire format flexible, reaching out to a certain sect of audience and globalizing the audience in a certain way, but finding your own commune while the physicality may have disappeared. And that gives an interesting opportunity, especially with respect to social movements. And that's where I'd like to rest and let you take.
So thank you. I think the format worked, okay? You were worried about whether this format will work. Second, I'll come to the second moment.
I'm not a film historian, yes.
You are. So we'll skip to the next, we'll go to the next moment. Actually, I'm skipping this huge moment in cinema called the coming of sound. We'll skip that. We'll come to the moment because we want to dwell more upon the present moment of cinema, which actually both of them are referring to, actually. What happened to the so-called cinema of the dark room and big image? this publicness of cinema and all. We'll come to that in the next stage.
This stage is actually the shift from the analog to the digital, which is a huge kind of shift as far as cinema is concerned, in the sense that it affected all the departments of cinema, like production. The way you conceive cinema itself changed, production patterns changed, distribution channels and modes changed, the way in which people, you know, watched cinema changed. So it was actually an all-encompassing kind of revolution that happened. Cinema as an art form, as a medium, as something that, you know, as a mass art, it changed the whole, you know, terrain of cinema as an art form, and also as an aesthetic experience. One thing, two or three things which I would like to point out about this markers of this change is, one is this deontologization of the image. Like, photographic image was evidence, was truth, because you needed pro-filmic reality to shoot something till then. Like, you needed something to actually create, even if you, George Millies, like that Padma Priya is referring to, like you had these two streams of film from the beginning. You had this realist school, which said the property of cinema is that it can capture reality, what is in front of the camera. Second, Millies school, as you call it, the magical stream, they said, you know, the whole fun of cinema is you can play with time and space, you can do whatever you want, you can create another reality. That is what cinema is all about. That is their argument. But with the coming of the digital, both these streams, both this realist kind of approach to cinema and also the magical approach to cinema, actually aggravated. Like, it opened up new avenues. So on the one side, there is a deontologization of image, which is actually, on the one side, photographic image, cinematographic image was no longer truth, no longer evidence. It didn't need a pro-filmic reality to make films. Secondly, cinema was liberated from the clutches of camera and also reality. You know, you have a situation where you can image whatever you can imagine. So you can create whatever images you want, the kind of movement and the kind of, you know, the imageries or characters or landscapes or in the moods or movements, totally liberated from the physical limits of the analog and celluloid. So this is a huge shift that happens as far as imagination of cinema is concerned. On the other side, also this cinematic image as a representation, as something that copied or reproduced reality, truth, is also lost. That is one basic shift. And also, like, so what happens is, like, as far as the viewer is concerned, it becomes a totally different kind of, like Peter Greenaway says, once the remote control was invented, cinema is dead. Like, because that was a moment when a spectator could intervene into the temporality of cinema, because it was something that you went and watched for 1.5 hours, 2 hours, without a break. You can't control it. The moment you can control it, he said, cinema is dead. You have to invent a new kind of cinema. We'll come to that later. So there is this kind of, you know, what happens is, like, the whole platforms change. This digital revolution actually brings in another kind of global circulation of images, text, information. It becomes global. It starts circulating all over the world. You have, you know, platforms like YouTube, which has virtually become the archive of cinema, of past, present, and in all kinds of cinemas. And it also makes possible the database cinema, where you don't shoot, actually use footages and make your own film. And also it made film viewing like book reading, you know, where you can freeze, you can go back, just like you flip the book, where you can go back to another chapter, you can go forward, you can freeze, you can watch an image as long as you want. Like, if you look at Bazan and all, a lot of people today say that there are a lot of factual errors in the book, basically because he watched live and then he had to write. He can't freeze, he just can't do it. Like, no, you can do it. So the whole, it affected theory, it affected the way in which people watched images, it affected the way in which cinema was imagined and produced. So that is the second moment where you bring in a kind of another kind of global circulation of images, another way in which cinema is, you know, produced, distributed, shared, seen, experienced, and also the kind of freedom that it gives both to the filmmaker
And the, as you are referring to the kind of, you know, the kind of systems that used to actually control the industry of cinema, the global circulation of images, actually breaks down. Like it goes into another kind of, you know, systems which is based on another kind of, you know, digital capitalism, and it takes a different kind of trajectory. Though cinema retained, I think, its hybridity and also its publicness.
I think this extension of this timeline is very rapid, actually. But what I'd like to add to what Priya and CS were talking is that, you know, I would also personally want to look at it
in a sense that, you know, on one level, the commercial entertainment cinema, when it was being seen by a mass audience and the global production, there is also this whole idea about cinema as a fine art made by very different kind of preoccupation post World War, where I think that tangle still survives. What had happened is that the mainstream cinema's opponents or its challenge from, say, for example, now the video game, for example, is huge actually. So, and it's also about spectacularness and the idea of consumption in a very different way.
Consuming is very important. Probably you are consuming your own lack of time at one level, actually. So that apart, what I want to say is that what you are probably looking at digital cinema today is also about the whole idea of online cinema, which is also a different archive. Cinema has been multiplexed, actually. Cinema has been divided. The idea of the frame, the idea of moment, the pixels. I would like to call it, you know, you are now bombarded with the concept of poor images. What is this poor image? Maybe on a lighter note, I would like to quote from a Woody Allen film. There's this Woody Allen film where, you know, the main actor he becomes out of focus. Now, it's not a technical problem, it's a rare disease that he imbibes by which he messes himself up and he can't be seen. Now what happens when you're out of focus, because it's like, you know, because you lose the class value of the image, actually. You're at one level, there's this whole high priest of cinema about resolution and stuff like that, but at the same time the kind of circulation has become totally different, actually. So I think the trans, what is interesting for me as a filmmaker is to now look at this phenomenon of rapid image bombardment. Now when there is an information, there is also counter information that comes up, you know. Suppose somebody comes up and says, you know, we have all democratized information. Somebody comes and says that there is something else beyond the end there happening. Now, how do you look at it? The counter information is just counter information, but it can be otherwise when you try to resist it. So I think the other cinema that probably people like me, I mean, I would say that I'm mythologically marginalized, actually. I have no visibility, actually, but I know that's the whole idea, you know. The whole avant-garde is also now being circulated. It has gone out of the academies, the archives. So what has happened in one level is that the online cinema excavation is actually in a deeper crisis. What is that crisis is also to be looked into. In a sense, it is the social of seeing, the idea of individuated experience, the idea of the individual as a subject matter is now far gone, actually. And probably you were mentioning about the digital proliferation. I'm more concerned about what is the digital uncertainty that is brought among people, actually, which is also the uncertainty of the technological unconscious, actually. Now see, on one level, you will have this phenomenon of Facebook, Instagram. There's this whole idea about the individuals wanting to vouch for high modernity, you know, and too much of self-glorification, of wanting to be visible. Now, I am more concerned about the clock of invisibility, actually, in this context, actually. So I think we haven't actually addressed it, but on one level,
if you look at the digital cinema, it has actually gone back to the facets of early cinema, actually. That is one aspect, actually. In terms of duplication, in terms of circulation, in terms of looping, all these things have created a kind of going back and re-looking at the cinema on one level. You want to add something more on that? Yeah. Okay. So what I'm trying to say is that, you know, me and CS, we were actually, there was a moment when the last IFFK and Fernando Solanas had come, actually. You know, what I'm trying to say is that Solanas represents a period probably in the 60s about third cinema, which is also called the imperfect cinema. So, you know, the imperfect cinema had a very different idea, actually, because it wanted to bridge the gap between the consumer and the director, the bureaucratic and the spectator. And, you know, they said that perfect cinema is absolutely reactionary cinema. It is in the imperfection that the summit is, actually. And this one interesting thing is about the exhibition. The imperfect cinema, or the cinema, the third cinema, was to show films in factories. And now factories have disappeared. In fact, what Priya was referring, you know, the first film was workers coming, I mean, arrival of the train, and Méliès was trying to, it was Lumière, I think, factory, workers leaving the factory. There are no more factory work, there are no more factories. In fact, if you go to Europe, the last that I went to Europe, one figured out that most of the factories and churches are converted to museums, actually. So museums have become factories now. So it's also a role reversal. In fact, yeah, time, man. Pardon? Yeah. So I think cinema is multiplexed already, and so what I'm trying to say is that the questions that the digital cinema has opened up, for example, let's say about this image proliferation. Yesterday I was reading this newspaper. There's something called, you know, social credit. It's something in China. You know, what is this social credit all about? I mean, it's on a lighter vein to end and round up this. Social credit is to look at your trustworthiness, actually. So it's like creating a huge data bank for, individuals to look into and look at what is the reputation of the individual. For example, the academy, there must be a few academics sitting here. They know about what is the choice-based credit system, which is there in our universities and arts college. Yeah. You earn credit. So I think it's like, you know, if you don't earn credit, then you can't be a good citizen. So for example, Priya is crossing the road. If you're not crossed it properly, you'll have to have penalty. But you won't pay it. Your children are going to pay it, actually. You know, that kind of thing, you know. So I think earlier the idea was that you have a self and you're looking at an image. Now you yourself are the image. So you had the idea of the family as a unit, community as a unit. All those have disappeared. You are the image, actually. So, I mean, with all this migration issue happening, it's going to be, I mean, if your father was not a proper citizen, you'll have bad karma. So you'll have to suffer on it and pay for it, actually. So I think the image in itself had a tussle with reality, and it has actually done a massive auto-destruction of itself, which means, are you really interested in the purity of image, or, you know, is there something called a pure image? Does the illusionary quality of an image exist? These are probably the questions perhaps we need to address as part of the regression.
Okay, I'm going to take a different take on this, right? Because I came into cinema as a performer sometime in the 2003-04 period. And this was exactly when there was a transition between analog to digital. We were moving from film to digital cameras, okay? So I had just finished shooting films like Karcha, which was shot in a shoestring budget on negative. And so every frame which was shot, like, you have to get the shot, damn it, right in that first take, right? And then you move to, I just two films done, I was like not even like an, I never intended to be an actor. So I was an accidental actor who happened to enter into cinema, and I ended up doing this. It worked for me because I came from a theatrical background. So I was like, okay, let's get this right and get it right in the first shot. And then my third film happened, which was in Tamil, Thavamai Tamil, which happened to be the first digital experiment. Which when it started, it was the first digital experiment, or one of the first digital experiments in the country, or in the South. Again, I'm not sure about the facts, but I remember that it was a matter of great concern to the cinematographer and the filmmaker. Okay, and roundabout, because it, I don't know why all my films took a year and a half to make, so this film also took a long time to make. Meanwhile, you had Mumbai Express come in, and all the fears of digital cinema and came to reality, because Mumbai Express, we didn't have the capacity to exhibit digital films. So a lot of places where Mumbai Express was shown, it had a very poor feedback, because you could not see the color properly, it was blurred, it was blah, 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 and we were like literally in between. And all that mattered to me as an actor was where I could finish something in one shot, I would have to take 20 shots, because now you had the digital space. You could record in as many tapes, and so you had, and so you lost the moment as an actor, right? So as a performer, I would be like, I don't want to retake shot 10 times. But that was the first adjustment that one had to make when you moved from analog to digital, like film to digital, sorry. It was an interesting moment, but very, very frustrating at that point. And also you realized and recognized, which comes back to the point which Vipin has been making, that we have to learn that cinema and technology are not divorced from each other. And there's a certain benefit to it, and there are certain disadvantages to it, right? The great benefit to having been part of the digital making was that you could actually play with the images till you got the image or the vision that you thought was absolutely perfect to your idea of what a good vision was, right? That may not be the way what a perfection like Vipin sees or somebody else sees. Like maybe I see perfection of a particular image in a certain way. And that's totally okay. To me, what the proliferation of the internet has done has that it normalizes the fact that there is nothing called an imperfect image or a perfect image. Yes, it does bring with its issue of authenticity, of what could be a pure image or should not be a pure image, but it also gives tremendous freedom for everybody to be part of the medium. And to me, that is extremely empowering. It could be disempowering because knowledge can be distorted as much as it can be made well. But this idea of knowledge has been, it's also interesting, which comes back, takes it back to the history, right? When you move from the Nickelodeon theaters to like the proper studio system theaters, automatically the class of audience which started participating in watching cinema changed. And hence the content and the kind of narratives which are when we talk about stopped being diverse. One classic interesting report which came out on the diversity, like this UCLA Institute kind of comes up with a diversity report every year in the US. And it's interesting that television today, or let's say internet television today, has far more opportunities for diversity in terms of participant, in terms of the kind of narratives that are being talked about in comparison to cinema. So have we lost the idea of trying to be able to tell a story through an image? Have we not been able to empower anybody? Like you could just go down the beach, shoot an image and say, this was the moment, this is how I saw that moment and tell your story through it. Haven't we been empowered by that? Is A person's story more integral than B person's story when you start imposing ideas like what is a pure image? Who is the spectator? Is the spectator somebody who has to be in a, I mean, the idea of, while it's beautiful, it's romantic, I have enjoyed being in a black room, but the idea of a black room was a purely technological thing. You could only watch the movie in a black space. Yes, through that you got in certain kind of intimacy, which was very unique. But today you don't need that black space to see it. You could probably wear a virtual reality goggle and probably be in a 3D space, and it can give you a totally different environment, and you could be experiencing that visual through a game. You can be experiencing that visual through a YouTube channel. You could be producing that yourself. It gives you it has really opened up a lot of opportunities. It also helps revisit a lot of people who are part of various social movements to become part of an to become an integral part of a medium which has extremely wide reach and had become, has in the last, I think in the last 20, 30 years, since 1980s or 90s, the entire star system which was brought about by the independent film industry has kind of literally throttled its existence. And what the digital has really done is, I wouldn't use the word democratized, that would be like, not a, liberated, yeah, that would be a perfect word. Does the liberation come with a certain cost? Yes. Do we need to be cognizant about it? Definitely yes, and cautious about it. But to kind of delimit it in the name of romanticism of the past, or romanticism of a past technology, which has its own beauty and charm, I'm not in any which way undermining it, but I think it's given a lot of freedom and independence to a lot of people to talk about their stories. And I think that, if that was the idea, if the whole idea was about bringing the human narrative to the fore, then I think cinema has probably gotten there somewhere, of bridging the gap between a market industry which requires scale for it to exist, but at the same time, the ability to be small.
I think we'll move to the next moment. The way it went is actually connects with the present moment, which I would call as the fragmentation of fragmentation of cinema in a sense. In the sense that the screen is, you know, splintered. Yes, you know, as Kamal Swarup image, he says the big silver screen has, you know, burst and splintered, and a bit has fallen in each home, you know, in the form of television or whatever. So there is this fragmentation.
Big screen
is like an elephant. Now when the bombardment happened, multiple tadpoles have come. So the problem with tadpoles is that it doesn't have a reproductive system.
So it is, yeah, well, yeah, that is the problem with the digital. So what we are talking about is like this fragmentation of cinema, in the sense that you're referring to the kind of excess that it creates. So excess in terms of like it gives a kind of, as with the digital, it gives the filmmaker freedom to, you know, shoot as long as much as possible. That is one thing. But it also actually affects, in a sense, the quality of attention to an image, because you had to bring a lot of care and attention to shoot an analog film, because you just can't, it's very costly, and you just can't see it then and there. You have to process it. The whole process changed, where you can watch it then and there. Then, you know, you go on shooting, and there is a kind of the quality of attention of the audience, and also the quality of attention to the image making practice itself undergoes a change. Second thing is the kind of excess that we live in, like the kind of huge excess of images through, as we said, like YouTube becomes a huge archive. Everything is available. Like you have in a whole archive of cinema of the past and present available there. So all this creates a kind of, you know, situation where you no longer have this kind of black box, very integrated kind of, you know, where people gather to watch something. There's a proper release. There's a kind of the way in which film is, it comes from the studio to the theaters to television.
I'm so sorry, I'm going to break you on this point, because I think it's important here too, because you're bringing the idea of spectator and commune, right?
Yeah.
But I'd like to ask you this question, while we kind of emphasize on this entire intention of these few people coming together and seeing a movie, I mean, as a woman, I could never go to a second show of a big film. So please tell me, how is it that this, whose commune is this?
Yeah, that is one question that I want to ask. Like, this, the question of access and the democratization of making of films. With the digital, there's ease of making films. It becomes affordable. A lot of, everybody is a filmmaker, and you can put it up on a platform that is globally accessible. That is one thing that digital has made possible.
Not just that. I could make a trans story today and put it up in digital, even in an Indian context, which you have seen with people like Farhan Akhtar's sister,
Zoya
Akhtar's film, and have a perfectly trans character. You have a perfectly trans character out there, or like a gay character out there in a so-called mainstream space, and actually make it legitimate, because you're seeing it in your private space. And I think the idea of commune here is that if I am gay and if I am watching a character which is gay, which is far more represented today on an OTT platform, my community of gays, even if it's unreal to you and not physical, is being automatically created in some way. And so, I mean, I just want to bring this out that this idea of commune need not always be a physical reality.
Not necessary at all.
Yes.
Like in the present,
and so the romanticism of it needs to be challenged a bit. Yeah,
definitely.
As well.
The, I'm not romanticizing it, nor does it, I would like to, you know, say like Berger says, you know, you once a kind of technological moment passes, you just can't bring it back. Only you can, what you can say is certain kind of grace has passed. You know, you have certain kind of grace to it, and you have to discover new kinds of gracious moments or whatever forms. So one thing is like about this excess and fragmentation of space, the fragmentation of temporality of cinema where you watch it at a go, and has it actually translated into the kind of diversity you're talking about? Has it actually become so diverse and different kinds of publics coming in where you have different kinds of, you know, films being made, as I said, not necessarily could be a database cinema. And what about the questions like somebody like Peter Greenaway is asking, like cinema is dead. He says, why this kind of, you know, tyrannies? He talks about four tyrannies of text. Why do you stick to text? He asks, why actors? Like, you can work otherwise. Like, why stick to frames? Because this frame is a kind of invention of Renaissance, you know, painting. Like, you have this rectangular frame. Why stick to it? You go to multiple screens. And
by the way, Manikau did that, right? Like,
yeah.
There was an attempt with...
So the question is, like, the present moment is full of possibilities in the sense, like, you have, as you said, like, you have a kind of different kind of globality of, you know, creating an audience for your film across the globe on the one side. On the other side, you also have this, the kind of tyrannies that cinema is still caught in, of the image, of the text, of the actor, of the camera, and all that. Are we able to act second? And also like the question of popular and art cinema, where art cinema, a lot of cinema is moving into, either somebody said cinema has become like opera, you know, where it is totally state makes films, people make watch and make other kinds of films. Second, the movement of actually the serious experimental cinema moving into galleries and, you know, spaces like biennales and, you know, museums, rather than mainstream theaters. Like, so how do you look at the whole, the new, the present moment.
Vipin, can I just jut in and then you can take on instead of going serially on this?
I have very little.
So, I mean, I feel this is a great opportunity even for art cinema. I think my concerns about the digital are a little different, which is again the market, right? When Facebook and Instagram and Google came in, we thought this is liberating. Honestly, there are organizations and corporations who own their data. Whoever has seen something like Black, I'm so bad with names. There's this brilliant UK TV series called Black something. Please Google it. But the Black Mirror, right? And almost like the first or second episode of it talks about the entire corporatization of human data and human emotions being maneuvered. And to me, the concerns are far more with digital corporatization more than digital projection. Okay. I actually feel that digital projection has probably interfered with the nature and the quality of the image, probably, but has definitely not interfered with the interpretation of what, it's challenged this idea of what is a pure image far more blatantly than any time in the past. It's also given an opportunity for filmmakers who do not want to subscribe to a certain way of storytelling or narrative to find their own space, and in a much bigger way. And that scale kind of gives you an advantage to make more. Because the problem, I think, for a long time with cinema is it's a very expensive art form. So you can't make it, Today, if you make an art film, I don't want to use the word art film, but you want to make a film which certainly probably attracts only 1% of, say, the audience of Kerala, it gives the opportunity through an OTT platform. If you had an art film OTT platform, so you had Netflix just for art, to actually reach out to making an art film which in Kerala, which could probably reach to an audience which otherwise would not have reached, and would only be through probably a film festival where only a certain class and creed of all people come into that kind of a festival, right? And so then the entire conversation, the creation of it, as you said, gets restricted to a certain space like a gallery, restricted to a certain kind of intellectualism, which may be good, which may not be good. I'm not taking sides here. But at least it provides, in terms of digital projection, a lot of opportunities which in the past was not possible. I mean, I literally know people who were like extremely right-winged TV journalists who have taken up to completely left-based journalism through YouTube by just becoming a single person new journalist, right? Like, I think this entire opportunity to move your even moral compass because of the change in the nature of the opportunities that the digital provides is immense. But the entire digital archives and who owns them is a far bigger concern to me, because while you think you are the producer, you are not. And while you think you're the consumer, you're not. And the kind of manipulation we have seen in votings and elections through Facebook, through Twitter, is a testimony to the fact that this is probably going to roll into cinema, which is probably the most impact. It already has, right? You have WhatsApp videos, what is the channel? The new video Instagram, what is it called? TikTok, right? If you think format was something which is flexible, and what if you consider them to be like, you know, people like whom we mentioned about throughout in this conversation to be part of film history, this is also as much part of film history. And they are in many ways expressing their own social, political, economic angst when they come out through these mediums and platforms. But I mean, really, to me, the concern is digital corporatization.
Too many layers, but I wonder, I want to ask you a question. Are there art films made in Kerala?
But you could make them now.
No, I mean, that was in a lighter vein, but I think for me personally, the Indian cinema is in serious crisis. If you look at world cinema, there is nowhere there a representation. And if you look at Southeast Asian countries, there's very important people, Apistyang Virasankul or Love Dies, making films. Anyway, that apart, what I wanted to to add to what she said is that this radical aestheticization is okay on one level, but Priya, not to forget the paranoia and the pornographic content that have kind of proliferated actually. Now, what I'm trying to say is that, you know, where does cinema become interactive? Where does cinema become immersive? You know, just this idea of sitting in a theater in a black room, and the black box concept of late capitalist advent of, you know, the contemporary art is totally different for me, because in a sense that, you know, there is a motor sensory mechanism that works within the theater, actually. So you're writing, imprinting, you know, that's what Tarkovsky said. You're imprinting a time, actually. And then the self of the audience actually is actually creating a very different sensorial experience. Now, this is important in a time that we live, which is full of eventlessness. In a sense that there's no event happening. In a sense that, Yeah. You're forcefully trying to do that. Now, in that sense, what is devoid of this event, what is happening is when there is eventlessness, is that you don't have an experiential world to recount. Now, I'm talking about the individuation that a filmmaker is interested in, actually. I mean, the idea is not to talk about the society, it is to talk against the society. You have a very different thing, you know. So I'm saying being in a theater and the immersive quality of cinema is about a locked-in situation. It is about you have an idea that the spectator's gaze is locked in with the gaze of the, you know, the subject of the matter. But that's totally different when you come to the space of contemporary art, because I think what happens, audience.
Okay. I'm so sorry, I have to make this statement, Vipin. I completely agree with you. The romanticism of a black room is very true. But honestly, as a woman, I don't want to make this a gendered argument alone. But as a woman, when I went into a black room, all I wondered was not the sensation that it created to me on the screen, but the creepy hand which will touch my backside. I'm not trying to make this into a different source of argument, but I'm saying that very space that you idolize because of the privilege that you come from of being a man took away that opportunity of romanticism in many ways which I would have liked to experience. Today, I experience that through digital cinema far better, in the privacy of my room, in the ability to talk to my partner very openly about a conversation, than in a space where I have to hoot and commit to a hoot of 100 others which I may just not agree to. And I think that's all I want to say and close it. I'm not trying to, I'm a big romantic when it comes to watching a film in a dark room. But and it does give a very, very strong sensory experience, and I will not take that away from him as a filmmaker. But as an audience, this has been my...
So what we're actually thought. What we're trying to say is that, like, the present moment is an ambivalent moment, where on the one side it opens up a lot of opportunities, on the other there is a huge centralization at work. For
Absolutely.
Instance, if you look at global media, it's owned by 6 corporations. Never had such concentration of media capital occurred in human history. So that is there. Like, we are working in a kind of certain kind of ambivalent moment where a lot of possibilities are opened up, like as you see on the streets, anti-CEA struggles. It is all about these opportunities where new ways are coming together, new ways of protest, dissent, exchanging ideas, and, you know, talking back to the state. That's happening on the one side. On the other, the whole question of surveillance and the kind of concentration of global corporate capital is a huge force to contend with. So any kind of democracy, So I think we have to give to audience, like.
Their attention traps, actually. Yeah.
Yes, please. Sorry for taking up so much time. Like.
And it's believed to be an attention trap. So at the end, you're not a producer and consumer.
Hello. This is the time of post-truth. So in the digital world, a lot of manufacturing of reality is happening. Still, now the, see the, this I'm asking about the OTT platform. So here, we see Irishman is most probably the Oscar-winning film, and Roma also was a big happening, and this was in OTT platform. So is it is a big opportunity coming, and is the OTT platform replacing the big studios in the future? I think it's happening very fast.
Well, I think that the question is like about these alternate kinds of platforms like Netflix, Amazon Prime, and all that we are referring to. It again has this ambivalent kind of thing. You look at the way in which Netflix has operated in India. Like, I'm not as, you know, positive about it as Padmapriya is. Like, it has actually, it's not going to work for alternate kind of cinema. It is going to work only for some kinds of commercial formats. And all these media platforms, whether it be Netflix or Amazon, Netflix claims they have 139 million viewers.
What do you think about a movie like Moonlight coming from nowhere? 3 black actors,
what I'm saying is like
actors.
It is the beginning. Like, what is happening if you look at the history of these platforms? Like, what is it? All works on algorithms. Algorithms are going to work in the favor of corporate capital. Okay,
yeah.
It's not going to work in your favor, in our favor. Like,
I agree.
It's a time for gift for participants.